Good morning, Life Church, Greater Lafayette. How's everybody doing today? Awesome. How many of you are doing better now than you were when you first came through the doors? Yeah, I mean, how could you not be doing better after great praise and worship like that? I mean, what great worship and what wonderful people to be gathering with and singing the praises of God. Amen. I think, do you appreciate your worship team? Do you ever let them know what a great job? Yeah, come on, let's give it up for them. I love worship. I absolutely do. You know, it's always exciting for my wife and I, Sheila, to get up to come over here. And, you know, I get excited to see, you know, what's happened since the last time we were here. And I came in this morning to the huddle and got to see all of the first serves. I'll tell you what, first serves during a pandemic, how many think that's absolutely awesome? Yeah. People getting involved for the very first time here at the church, and you know, that's just awesome to see. And then I see faces that I don't recognize, so I got a feeling, I actually know from talking with John and Brittany, that you guys are like us. We may be going through a very unusual time in history and in our nation, but the church flourishing. The church is doing well, and people are being added to the church. Amen. And we've had an influx of new people over the last several months. There's a lot of the older faces that I am familiar with that I have yet to see. But what's amazing is every week, every service, we have new faces. And so we're very, very excited about that, and you have that happening here. So we're growing, and good things are happening. You actually have some of the people that are from our congregation that have moved over here, and now they're going to be a part of your congregation. Mike and Missy, would you raise your hands? Just let everybody know who you are. The Dells, yeah. Yeah, and, you know, I thought they were making a huge, you know, effort just to show me how supportive they were of me. And we're here today showing up to hear me preach. Just love to hear me preach so much. And I said, hey, you guys, you know, and said something to that effect. And they said, no, actually, we've made the move. We're over here. This is our first Sunday. So just let the air out of my balloon. And then, Kale, you weren't the least bit funny. In fact, you may be in danger of the flames. I'm not going to say any more than that. Put a San Diego hat on my lap in the morning. What a terrible thing to do. But anyway, Cub fans have to get back at us. Cardinals any way they possibly can. Isn't that right? Hey, anybody excited about the fact that you're going to be in your own facility here in just a few months? Yeah, 3 months. Probably 3 months. And I got to work the last couple of weekends over here helping. Yes, I work. And, you know, I've done a lot of this and dive right in. Yesterday was one of the most challenging when it comes to demolition and just cleaning up a mess. And thank you so much for those of you who helped. I got to work with a lot of the college students yesterday, and man, this congregation is just blessed with a good group of people, but I love seeing the college age. And Mike made the statement, he said, you know, no offense, but he said, this campus seems to have a lot more younger people coming to it. So anyway, I guess once you decide you're coming over here, you're not going to be over there, you can just say anything that's a slam and not think about it, right? So anyway, no. But there is a younger group, and that's awesome. We are a church for all generations. In fact, we want to thank three, because that's how God does it, isn't it? He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We are always thinking generationally about everything that we do. So just good things happening. We have nothing but wins to talk about and awesome things that God is doing in both houses. And I'm excited about the future for Life Church. How about you? Amen. So I need to hurry because I have a lot to share, and I don't have a whole lot of time to share it in. And I absolutely love the fact that you guys are talking about I love my church. And that's not what we're talking about over at the Danville campus, but we're going to take what I'm talking about and what you're talking about and bring them together, merge them together, because they fit tremendously well with what John and Britt have asked for me to share with you about today. You know, I love the church. And my wife and I, the church has been our lives for the last 45 years. I mean, we just live and breathe the church. And I get around pastors who talk about, you know, what a challenge it is to be a pastor and how hard it is to be in ministry and, you know, how much they've suffered. And they just make it sound horrible, and maybe it has been for them. We don't have any of those sad songs to sing. We don't have, I can't get up here and make it sound like it's been all that. We've made a lot of sacrifices. We've been through a lot of difficult times, but I'm just going to tell you now, the good so far outweighs all of the negative that, that's what we focus on. We just focus on the good things that God is doing, and he just continues to do that, and we're just expecting him to do that moving forward in our futures. So I love the church. So we're talking about that and marrying it with the vision of our church: know God, find freedom, discover your purpose, and make a difference. And today I'm talking about making a difference, and which is really all about being generous. And as Britt said, generous with your time, generous with your talents, which is all about you serving, but also generous with your treasures, which is all about you being a good steward over your resources, honoring God with your resources, using your resources for more than yourself, using your resources to advance the kingdom of God. And I want to remind you that while there's a lot of things you can buy in life that are going to make you happy, there's very little that you can do with your money in life that has eternal value. But anytime you're investing your money into the kingdom of God, anytime you're investing your money into God's house, how many know there's eternal value in that? Because there are people being reached every Sunday, and for that matter, there are people being reached every day of the week because of the money, because of the finances, the treasure that you're giving to support God's house. Can you see that? You know, I think about making a difference, and I could talk a lot about serving, but I think, you know, you have talked about that, so I'm not going to go back on that and talk about that. Your serving is so very, very important. You make a difference with your serving. But when I think about the people who have made the greatest difference in our ministry, the greatest difference in the life of Life Church over the years, it is the people, first of all, who've been very faithful in their support through just their general tithe and offering. Every week, you can just count on the fact that they're tithe, honoring God with the first fruits of their increase. That first 10%, it's going to be there. Now, not everybody does that. In fact, you know, the percentage is not what we would like for it to be. But there is this group of people who are very faithful to honor God with their tithe and offering, and it's because of them that we've been able to do all of the things that we've done over the years. And then we've had those seasons, which you're in one right now, where there's a special project that's before you. And it really takes more than just tithe and offering at that point to do that. People have to go over and above. The Bible talks all the time about going over and above. And so we have these people who always step up to the plate, and they go over and above, and they give beyond their tithe and offering. The tithe and offering kind of makes everything during the normal week and the life of the church happen, but when you're in places like we are right now, you need extra. And so John and Britt have come to you and said, hey, we need you to do over and above. Guess what? Over at the campus in Danville, we're saying the same thing to them because we are one church, two locations. We got your back. You're not in this alone. We're in this together. We're going to help you get this done, pull this off, and to God be the glory. Isn't that right? And so we've been talking every week. I'm talking to the people over there. Come on, let's do something here. Let's get behind John and Britt. Let's get behind the Greater Lafayette campus, and let's do something big for them. Let's let them know that we're there for them. Amen? And, you know, I'm not ready to tell you exactly where we're at as far as that's concerned, but I will tell you it's going to be significant. And we're going to do this. We're going to pull this off. We're going to be in that building in 3 months, and when we get in there, it's going to look nice. Amen? I say 3 months. I hope it's 3 months. So the whole point is this, is that difference makers are generous. Difference makers are givers. Let me assure you of that. They are generous with their time. They're generous with their talent, and they are generous with their treasure. So what keeps us from being generous? Because sometimes people aren't. Sometimes you might be a generous person, but not always generous. And maybe, you know, you're just in one of those times where because of the pandemic, because of the place you're in right now financially, being generous just isn't something that you're feeling, that you're really thinking you can do or that you want to do. And no matter who you are today, I want to talk to you about it, but I especially want to talk to you if that's kind of where you feel like you are. I think You know, there's a lot of reasons, you know, that we tend to not be generous. I think, you know, we can be greedy and selfish. We can just really kind of be thinking about ourselves all the time. And, you know, we all like ourselves and we all want what everybody else has. And so, you know, we want to make sure that we've got enough for ourselves. And that's a message for another time. I think, though, one of the biggest reasons people tend to not be generous is just the fear of not having enough. The fear of not having enough. But I want to remind you, as I get started with what I want to share with you today, is that we serve the God who is the God of more than enough. And can I tell you, there is no one. You go in your Bible, you show me, you find me one place where people gave, whether they were just giving tithes and offerings or whether they were going over and above with giving sacrificially, the last of what they might have had in the moment, whether it's the widow who makes the cake for the prophet or if it's the little boy who gives his 5 loaves and 2 fishes. You show me anybody in Scripture who gave what they had and they ended up with less than their life. Or, come on, ended up going under. Can I tell you, anybody who gave to God, anybody who gave to the purpose of God, how many know God blessed them for doing that? Isn't that right? They always ended up not just with equal to what they gave, but they always ended up with much, much more than what they had. Can I tell you, I believe God wants to bring us into a much, much more life. I believe God wants to bring us into a place where we have more than what we have right now so that we can be even more generous on every occasion as it arises in the future. But as long as we're allowing the fear of not enough rather than the faith that we should have in the God who's more than enough drive us, how many know we're going to have a hard time being generous at any time, at any season in our life? So I just want to give you just some really kind of basic things. The title of my series is actually The Double Blessing. Believe it or not, I've been in it for 2 weeks, and I have really yet to talk much about the double blessing. I'm going to, probably next week, but the reason I haven't been talking about the double blessing is because I'm smart enough to know that there are a whole lot of people that are sitting in the seats in Danville, and there are a whole lot of people sitting in the seats here in Lafayette that, you know, have a problem believing that they're blessed, period, let alone believing that God wants to give them a double blessing. So I really just want to establish the fact that you are blessed today and get you to see God as a God who is a God who blesses you. Because it makes a huge difference when you see yourself as blessed. In fact, when you begin to see yourself as blessed, it will change how you go through life. It'll change how you approach life. So it'll change how you live. It'll also change how you give, and it'll change how you face the challenges of life, the lean times of life, the times when there's problems in your life. And all you have to do is think about David. Little old David walks there on that battlefield that nobody else will walk out on. And, he's ready to step up to the plate and take on a giant called by the name of Goliath. And you know why he does that? He does that because he knows he has a covenant with God. He does that because he knows that he has the blessing of God. He's not praying, God, I sure hope you're with me and I get this pulled off. He steps up out there, steps out there on that battlefield without praying about it, without thinking about it. He just does it because he knows he can, because not because he's a great fighter, but because he knows that he is in covenant with God, that God is with him and God is for him. And because of this, he can pull it off. He's blessed. Everybody say he's blessed. You are blessed, and you need to see yourself as blessed as you are walking through life, especially when it doesn't look like it, especially when it doesn't feel like it. You need to know that you are. So real quickly, here's the first thing that you need to know. You need to know that it's God's nature to bless. It's God's nature to bless. In Genesis chapter 1, when we have creation being, you know, written down there for us, on day 6, God creates man. And whenever you're looking at God creating, whenever you're looking in Genesis especially, and you're seeing everything begin to happen for the very first time, you need to understand that God is setting precedent. And it's God really kind of establishing who he is, what he's all about as he's doing these things. So he creates man, and when he creates man, it says, and the very next thing he does after he creates them is this, he says, and God blessed them. Everybody's saying, God blessed them. So he's letting us know that it's his will for us to be blessed. Isn't that right? He's letting us know that it's his nature to be blessed. I went to a church that, you know, I don't think I would ever have been convinced by anything I heard there that God, it was God's nature to bless. By the way they preached on Sunday morning, it sounded like it was God's nature to get ticked off real easy. It sounded like it was God's nature to get you, that he was just kind of watching for you to mess up. And I know you're all a whole lot better person than I probably have ever been, but back in the day, I was a mess up. And so, you know, from one Sunday when I'd give my life to the Lord to the next Sunday, you know, I would mess up. Come on, anybody know what I'm talking about? And so, you know, instead of me finding out more about the Lord and growing in the Lord and walking in the goodness of God, they'd preach on, you know, God's going to get you. You know, you know, if you've been sinning, which I always did, and, you know, I was good at it. I seemed to be gifted at that, you know, back then. And so anyway, I'd be messing up. So at the end of the service, I'm just, you know, raising my hand, recommitting my life back to God, just wanting to get right with him again. You know, I'm glad I finally know that I'm right with God, not because of my good works, but because of what Jesus did for me on Calvary's cross. It's not my righteousness. That's filthy rags. It's righteousness that's been imputed to me through what Jesus did for me at Calvary. Amen? And here's the good thing. God's not out to get you. He is, but it gets you not in a bad way, but gets you in a good way. He's out to bless you. It's his nature to bless. Bless is what God does naturally. It's his basic reflex when it comes to our life. It really is his default mode when it comes to his relationship with us as his people. So it's his nature to bless. Everybody say it's his nature to bless. Look at your neighbor and say, God wants to bless you. Yeah, well, and really the truth is he already has. So that's man before the fall. Man, after the fall, God begins to reintroduce himself to his people. And in the book of Numbers, after he's brought them out of Egyptian bondage, again, he's establishing precedent, how he wants to work with them, how he wants them to know him moving forward. So in Numbers chapter 6, he tells Aaron and his sons, who are the priests over the people of Israel, what they are to say over the people. And we actually call it the priestly blessing. And I think you guys have been doing the song, the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face shine upon you. How many of you love that song? That's Bible. That's actually from this passage that I'm going to read to you here. And so this is what God says, I want you to be saying to the people. He says, tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you're to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. So they will put my name on the Israelites, and I will bless them. So he says to Aaron and his sons, I want you to bless my people. I don't want you cursing them. I don't want you saying negative things over them. I know they're people. I know they got shortcomings. I don't want you getting up there just declaring their shortcomings all the time. I want you to bless my people, and here's how I want you to bless them. And those three things that he says there tells us three basic areas that God's blessing covers in all of our life. And I think really it's pretty an all-sufficient blessing, the truth be known. But first of all, the blessing provides us with protection. The Lord bless you and keep you. Can I tell you, I know we're in a pandemic, and I know we need to use wisdom. I'm going to use godly wisdom, wisdom that's driven from the principles of God. I'm not going to use fear-driven wisdom, which is what I see a lot of people operating in, going more by what man is saying than what God is saying. And the reason is because, and I, you know, I get social distancing. I get wearing a mask. I'm not against any of that. But I'm just going to tell you, my faith is not in a mask. My faith is not in you standing 6 feet away from me. Come on. My faith is in my God who has promised that he will bless me and he will keep me. If he can't keep me in a pandemic, he can't keep me. Amen? If he can save me and get me to heaven, I figure he can bless me and he can keep me. You know, folks, what if we actually acted like we believe the Bible? What if we actually acted like when God said, I'll keep you, I'll protect you? How many of you know, and I got to be careful, I'll run out of time so quick. Psalms 91, I got a series that I put together, haven't even preached yet, that I can't wait to preach. I might have to wait till the next pandemic to preach it, though, because it's kind of, it's one of those. But it says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I'll say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my strength, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. One of the things in there is this. It says, no pestilence come nigh your dwelling. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand. Come on. I think a pandemic, I think COVID-19 probably falls in there somewhere. And I hear the Lord in heaven saying, hey, church, don't forget I'm up here. And I've already blessed you. Healing is a part of your covenant. I got your back. Come on. How many of you believe God will keep you? Yeah. God will keep you. Yeah. So anyway, I just think you need to be careful about, you know, just telling people that because then they'll get, you know, whatever. I hope the only thing I do is encourage you, inspire you to have more faith in the God that you serve today. All right, so protection, favor. The Lord make his face shine on you. That's all about God just showing you favor, being gracious to you. And by the way, favor is providing you with special advantages. And by the way, as far as I'm concerned, the building that we just leased, we got the favor of God because we got a crazy good deal on it. And, you know, thank God for his favor. How many of you like it when God just favors you? Amen? And then also peace, because he said the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And when it says turn his face towards you, it means that you have his attention. You have his attention and that he is looking upon you with approval. And these people were no different than you and I. Actually they were. They had the blood of bulls and goats that was covering their sin. We have the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that covers our sins. So as far as that goes, how many know we're actually in a better place than they are? Amen. God looks at us not through the blood of bulls and goats, but he looks at us through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. I hadn't said this to the church and to the campus in Danville yet because I didn't think about it until this week, and I didn't really get it. But in verse 27, it says, so they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. And I just realized what it's saying there is this. You know that there are many names. One guy says 400 names that God has revealed himself by in the Old Testament. And it is just God revealing another dimension of his character. He's our Savior. He's our Redeemer. He's our Healer. He's our Protector. Come on. How many know he is all those things? Isn't that right? And so when he's saying, I will put my name on them, he's saying, I am blessing you with everything that I am. I am blessing you with all that I am. Amen? Folks, we are a blessed people. Can I get a better amen than that? You know, that blessing actually was ensured their success moving forward. And in fact, 40 years later, they, you know, the River Jordan parts so that they can begin to make entrance into the promised land. The walls of Jericho come tumbling down, and they end up defeating the giants that are in the land, and they go in and possess the land. They did that all because of the blessing of God being on their life. Listen, you can't do that stuff unless God is for you, God is with you, and God is blessing you. But he was. But, how many know, they could have went in 40 years later, or 40 years earlier, if they'd have walked in the blessing. See, they forgot the power of the blessing. They said, who are we? They're giants. We're not able. Listen, don't sit around and think, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I'm just on my own. You are not your own. Come on. How many know God is with you? God is for you. Isn't that right? They could have went in and possessed that land 40 years earlier if they'd have just walked in the power of the blessing. I wonder how much you and I are missing out on simply because we view ourselves, you know, as mere men, as unable, not having everything that we need, instead of viewing ourselves through Jesus and realizing that we are blessed. And we are blessed with everything that we need to be successful in life. In fact, get this. Not only do you have the priestly blessing of number 6 on you, you've got more than that. Because in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, the Apostle Paul says, praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessing, with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I don't just have that priestly blessing. I have every blessing. You have every blessing upon you that heaven can afford you, that heaven has to offer. Every spiritual blessing is upon you. Again, I come from a church where they would say, that says spiritual blessings, preacher. It doesn't say physical blessings. It doesn't say anything about material things or whatever. It's spiritual blessings, pastor. I love all these spiritual people. Come on. Spiritualize everything. But can I tell you, everything is spiritual, including the natural things in your life, whether you realize it or not. And again, that's another subject to talk about some other time. But, you know, I think those people often think that a spiritual blessing is something you feel during the service. I just felt so blessed. Well, good. Hope you enjoyed it. Didn't last long. Come on. I want blessings that last a little longer than that. Now, the blessing will make me feel good. But spiritual blessings all produce natural things in your life. Spiritual blessing parted the River Jordan. Spiritual blessing, come on, brought the walls of Jericho down. Spiritual blessing enabled them to defeat the giants. Spiritual blessings on you in your life enable you to do anything and everything you need to do to walk in the abundant life and fulfill your purpose and destiny in the cause of Christ. Amen. You got everything you need. Everybody say, I got everything I need. All right. So now, let me just tell you why God blesses you. Because I think there's a lot of, you know, maybe wrong thinking around this. You know, first of all, the biggest reason is he blesses you because he loves you. Wow. Where'd you get that? Deuteronomy. Listen to this. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 8, it says, That's another verse. That I'm not going to have time to go to. In Deuteronomy 23:5, it says, however, the Lord your God would not listen to Balaam. Now remember Balaam, because Balak had hired him to curse the people of God. And so Balaam is a prophet. He goes and seeks God, and he says, you can't curse him because I've blessed him. And so Balaam comes back and says, I can't curse him because God's blessed him. And he actually says these nice things about the people of Israel. He blesses them. And he ticks Balak off because he's paid him to curse them. And he says, you know, shut your mouth. Stop, you know, stop saying stuff. I ask you, I paid you to curse them, and you're blessing them. And Balaam says, I can't curse what God has blessed. Come on. So people, I'm just walking around under this curse. Only if you allow the enemy to deceive you into that, and, you know, that's kind of how you allow it to impact your life. There might be negative things come against you in your life. The enemy might try to get you to walk under a curse, but the enemy and nobody else and nothing else in life can curse what God has blessed. You have the power to break anything that is coming against you because you're blessed, not cursed. I had a moment, I had a season in my life one time where every time I turned around, something bad was happening. And it was just stupid stuff, but it was costing me money, causing me trouble. I'm out on the lawnmower one day, and I'm thinking about it. I'm a little aggravated at God. I'm just thinking, you know, God, what's up? And that's actually what I said. What's up? Am I doing something wrong? You know, is there sin in my life? You know, what's up? You know, that's how we think. And I heard the Lord speak back to me and said, take authority over it. Bring it to a halt. You know, I found out in my life anyway, when God speaks to me, I don't hear an audible voice. I hear Him on the inside. I just hear what He says. He never preaches a sermon to me. He always says, it's always really short, but I get it. I stopped my lawnmower right then and there, and I said, Father, you're right. I've been griping, but I haven't been taking any authority. I've been complaining about what the devil's doing, but I haven't been taking any authority over it. Luke chapter 10, verse 13. Behold, I give you authority over all of the power of the enemy. Nothing he does shall by any means harm you. So I just said, Father, in Jesus' name, I take authority over the devil. He's not going to steal from me anymore. This comes to a halt right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody said, did it stop? It stopped. Now, did it stop and it never has happened again? No, that rascal will come back around again. And he'll wait and see if you've kind of forgotten about your authority again and see if you'll put up for it a while. Amen. And so sometimes we just need to stop and take authority over what the enemy's doing. That just spoke to somebody. Some of you have been wondering, what is going on? It's the devil. Oh, he's after me. Put it to a halt. The devil, your enemy, is a defeated foe. Amen? So why does God bless me? No, listen, I didn't finish reading the verse. However, the Lord your God would not listen to Balaam, but he turned the curse into a blessing for you. Why? Because you're just the best people on earth. You just never sin. No, he says, because the Lord your God loves you. Oh, the Lord your God loves you. Everybody say, the Lord loves me. Wow. You know, I've heard people just say, you know, it's a good thing he's got a mama because a mama's the only person who could love him. Can I tell you, I don't care who you are, no matter who else doesn't love you, I don't care if anyone else loves you, God loves you. And man, when God loves you, whether anybody else loves you or not, how many know you're good? You can make it. You can come out. So man, I don't have anybody shows up in my life. I'll tell you what, God will show up in your life. Amen? And eventually, he'll have some people that will show up in your life too. But God will be God to you. Why? Because he loves you so much that he gave his only begotten son. Amen? He loved you that much. Romans 8:29 says, he who spared not his own son but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Wow. He said, listen, if I gave you Jesus, there's nothing else that will ever arise in your life that you'll ever need that I won't give you also. Amen? You're blessed. Everybody say, I'm blessed. Okay, so why does God bless me? Because he loves me. But I tell you what, it ain't all about me. The other reason he blesses us is so that we can be a blessing. And the moment we forget this, and the moment we make the blessing all about us only and just us living a better life, the blessing will begin to stop flowing in your life because you become a dam rather than something that is allowing the blessing of God not only to flow to you, but also to flow through you. So this is, where do you get this? Genesis chapter 12, verse 2, where God tells Abraham, he says, as for me, this is the covenant that I will make with you, and I will bless you, and you shall be a blessing. And can I tell you, as you read throughout the Bible, you see where God has called us not just to be a people who are blessed, but to also be a blessing. He blesses us so that we can be a blessing. And the more we bless people, listen, God really bases your stewardship. Your stewardship is all about living within your means, for sure. But can I tell you, I know people who live within their means, and yet they are not good stewards of the money that God brings to their hands because they still, we don't have a lot. You know, we're good stewards over it. We make ends meet. Can I tell you, even then, a good steward will take and they will honor God with that which is rightfully his. They'll honor God with their tithe and offering because he's commanded us to do that. We're not good stewards over the resources of God if we're only using what he brings to us for ourselves. We're good stewards when we use it to also flow through us to be a blessing. He gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So he gives us bread for eating and seed for sowing. And every check you get, there's bread for eating. There's plenty in there for you as far as your needs and stuff, but there's also seed for you to sow. Can I tell you what happens whenever you eat your seed rather than sow your seed? You eat your seed rather than sow your seed. You don't have any crops ever coming up. And then you're upset at God because you're not being blessed. And you're not doing as well as whoever. And again, the reason is because you're eating what you should be sowing. Amen. It got quiet in this Presbyterian church. Can I tell you, I found out anytime, so it doesn't bother me. I've done this too long. You get quiet. Don't make me no difference. I'm still going to preach truth to you. Whether you like it, whether you don't, whether you agree with it, whether you don't, whether you're critiquing or you're not, whether you amen me or not, don't make me any difference. I found out when you talk about kids, sex, and money, it gets real quiet in the church. I haven't mentioned your kids, and I haven't mentioned sex. So it must be the money issue that gets us just a little bit quiet. Is that all right? You know what? God wants to set us free from even that spirit where we're uncomfortable talking about money, or we're uncomfortable when someone is telling us that it really is God's will for us to be generous with what he brings into our lives, no matter how small that may be at the moment. Can I tell you, if you think small, and this is all we have, and that's how you live, you never give, can I tell you, you're probably going to live the rest of your life that way. If you want to live a larger life, listen, I come from very humble background. I'm very humble beginnings. My dad was a mechanic. We lived paycheck from paycheck. My dad was a good Christian man, but nobody really taught faith in the church that we went to. And they loved God. They were on their way to heaven. They shouted all the time, but they just didn't know anything like that. And, you know, so I know what it is. My wife and I, when we first got married, my first job paid $90 a week. And somebody says, yeah, but $90 went a whole lot further back then. I don't remember it going any further, but if you say so, I mean, $90 is $90. Can I tell you, the first week my wife and I got married, I sat down there and I thought, oh my gosh, you know, I'd been tithing off of the money that I'd gotten. I'd been taught well by my dad to do that. And so I'm sitting there and it dawns on me, dude, you're married. Now you got to buy food for two. Now you got, you know, other stuff you're going to have to pay, you know, for. And how in the world are you going to do this? You can't afford to tithe. Now, my tithe would have been $9, and I gave a dollar offering. So, you know, that's a big offering when you're only making $90. So I remember in that moment, I made a decision. You know what? Rather than holding on to this $10 here like it would really make a difference, God, if I've ever needed you and your blessing, I need it right now. So instead of holding on to it, we've been tithers all of our lives. We're not just tithers. We're also givers. And can I tell you, whenever God enriches you and you in turn enrich others and you help advance the kingdom of God, I promise you, you cannot outgive God. God will just keep blessing you in ways that are beyond your wildest imagination. It just comes through so many, so many, many ways. Amen? So it's God's nature to bless. Everybody say it's God's nature to bless. What was my second point? God wants you to know that you're blessed. I don't think I said that, did I? That's why you didn't know. And then here's the third one, and I'll just give it to you real quick because I don't have any more time. And I always run out of time. You ever notice that? You got to position yourself to walk in the blessing of God. And that's a message really in and of itself. But I just want to talk to you just for 3 or 4 minutes here about positioning yourself to walk in the blessing of God. Anytime you're going to position yourself to enjoy anything God has for you, the first thing you have to have is faith. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is, now watch the blessing, and believe that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. In other words, God said, you put your faith in Me, there's a blessing that always comes from putting your faith in God. Amen? So you gotta have faith in God. You gotta believe that He's a good God, that it's His nature to bless, and that whenever you give, He honestly is going to do exactly what He says, and He's going to multiply your seed sown back to you. You're going to make a sacrifice, but it's only going to be momentarily because God's going to bring abundance into your life. So you got to have faith. The next thing, you got to change the way you think. You got to change the way you think. You got to stop thinking lack and start thinking abundance. And that really is a shift in the way that we think. Psalms chapter 1, verse 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, nor sits in the way of the sinner, or walks in the way of the sinner. For his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in His law does he meditate day and night. He's going to be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of living water. His seed will and whatever he does will prosper. Whatever he does will be blessed, in other words. But the whole thing starts by not walking in the counsel of the ungodly. I change the way I think. I start thinking, again, in line with God's Word. I'm not cursed. I am blessed. When I give, I'm not going to end up with less. I'm going to end up with more because that's what God's Word says. Amen? And then I have to start obeying the Word, just being obedient. That's the third point, to positioning myself to walking in the blessing of God. Deuteronomy 20. 8 verse 1 says, let me read it to you. I don't think they have it on the screen. Deuteronomy 28 verse 1. Now it shall come to pass that you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all His commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you hearken diligently, if you listen to the voice of the Lord your God and you do what He tells you to do in His Word. I love that. He said, just obey My Word. And when you do, He doesn't just say you'll be blessed. I love the way it's worded in the New King James. That's why I used it. He said, all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you. You're going to get ran down by the blessing of God. Wow. Come on. You know, I'm not a very fast guy, but there are people that are slower than me. And so they can take off running, but you know what? I can come up on them and overtake them because I'm a little faster. But I've watched my grandson, Max. I've watched him run. He's not much faster than me, but he's a little faster. No, he's a little faster. So trust me, by the time I got the hop out of my step from just taking off, he'd probably catch up. But because he's faster, he can come up on me and overtake me. Can I tell you, life happens. Life happens. Life happens to all of us. But what's so awesome is, whenever we're obedient to God, I love this. It just works. I know it works. When we're obedient to God, life's happening, but the blessing of God still comes upon me and overtakes me. The blessing of God always, come on, outruns what the enemy, what life is bringing against me. Amen? But I've got to be obedient. Can I tell you, I remember when I first started doing all this, it was such a struggle to do it all. There was fear still there, and, you know, I didn't get it right a lot, and I don't always still get it all right. But can I tell you, when I started honestly living in this and just walking with confidence in this, it's just amazing how much more enjoyable life is and how much more at peace I am. My wife will tell you. My kids will tell you. You know, trouble comes. We've had things happen since we started this campus. John and Britt, not as far down the road as Sheila and I are. They've gotten a little bit concerned about things. And when they come to me, they don't get it. Oh, yeah, I don't know, man. You guys might be thinking about going and finding a job because, you know, Mom and I may have, you know, that's they don't get that from me. You know what they get from me? Okay, I know. I see it too. But I'm just going to promise you, we're going to come out of this. We're going to do just fine. Can I tell you? That's, you know, back, and we're coming out of it. We're doing just fine. God's meeting all of our needs according to the pandemic and whether the government's going to give us another check or not. No, how many know he's doing it according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? Amen. They want to send me another check. Anyway, that's okay too, right? I put windows in my patio with the last check they sent me. I thought, thank you, Uncle Don. But anyway, or whoever that came from. So, I'm terrible, ain't I? Am I okay? Listen, if you're religious, you won't like me. I just know that. Because I'm just as simple. And when I read the Bible, I just don't see religious stuff. I see a life manual. I see a God who loves me when I was unlovable. Loved me so much that he gave Jesus for me. I see a God who wants me to have life and to have it more abundantly. Whether life and religion try to keep me from it or not, that's what he wants. And if I just actually believe that he is who he says he is and do what he says he'll do, my life can be so crazy, crazy good. And I'll be 64 here in just a few months. Can I just tell you, I have nothing but good to say about God and his ability to work in our life and to just see us through whatever goes on and just be a crazy blessing to us at all times. Amen? Do we know what it is to go through scarce times? Yep. But I've never seen the righteous forsaken, his seed out begging for bread. God always comes through. God always meets your needs. Amen? Here's the last thing I'm going to talk to you about, and I've already said it through everything I've talked about. If you're going to position yourself for blessing financially, I'll say that. I'll qualify as far as your finances, you want to be blessed there, and I don't know anybody who doesn't, then you've got to honor God with your tithe and offering. Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 says, "Will a man rob God? And yet you have robbed me." You say, "Well, how have we robbed you, God? How could anyone possibly rob you?" He said, "You've robbed me of the tithe and offering." You can't rob somebody of something that doesn't belong to them. And the Bible tells us in the book of Leviticus that the tithe belongs to the Lord, that it is holy unto the Lord. Whenever God blesses you with the check that you get for the earnings that you earn during the course of that week, let me tell you, that first tenth doesn't even belong to you. That first tenth belongs to God, and you're a good steward if the first thing you do is that you honor him with that. Isn't that right? And he says this. He says, bring all the tithes. Bring all, not part. Bring all the tithes. Yeah, but I'm going through a difficult time. All the more reason. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so that there's resource, so that there's provision in his house. Watch this. See if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you that is more than just sufficient. Amen. Where's the blessing come from? From me honoring God with my tithes and offering. Amen. From me giving. Amen. When I give, it's like, if I sow apple seeds, I get apples. If I sow kindness, I get kindness. Come on. If I steal money, I get money. Come on. Hey, I don't believe. Well, I'm just, you know, I'm just not all about the money. Well, let God bless you with it and bring it to me. We'll always find a place. We got more vision than we do resources anyway. That's always the case. Amen.